Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst, 15th February 2019. Today we will be discussing these five articles. The first one is related with new draft e-commerce policy to be released by DPIIT. The second is related with Pradhan Mantri Shram Yogi Mandan Yojana. The third is related with the new model mooted for credit rating agencies. The fourth article is related with the dysfunctions associated with the India's waste to energy power plants. The last one is related with the minimum ages fixed by a panel. Data localization was the key recommendation made by the Sri Krishna Committee. Data localization has found its impact on RBI notification earlier last year. Now in the draft e-commerce policy to be released by DPIIT, it has found a place too. The Department of Promotion of Industries and Internal Trade has been working on a new draft e-commerce policy. This draft policy is focusing on one important factor, which is known as data localization. So what is data localization? Data localization or data residency is a law that requires data about a nation's citizens, which is being collected, processed, stored inside the country whenever they are being transferred internationally, and they should be transferred only after getting consent from a local law authority. That is what these data localization or data residency law speaks about. And it becomes important in e-commerce sites because many of us are shopping in e-commerce sites. Say for example, we do shop for books, or we do shop for dresses in Amazon or Flipkart. Both of them, Amazon is a fully owned American company, whereas Flipkart, the major stake is held by Walmart. So the data which we give in the e-commerce sites being stored in their servers, which is located in India. Since their stakeholders are from other country, there are chances and the data are transferred from India to other countries. This is posing threat to privacy of Indian citizens. In this aspect, the data localization clause in the draft e-commerce policy becomes more important. We all know that the BN Sri Krishna Committee, formed in order to make a framework for privacy, cited that critical personal data should be stored and processed only in India. The critical personal data include a person's bank account, a person's address, a person's mobile number, a person's email. Providing these data to a people or any agent living out of the country will pose threat to national security, and it also amounts to breach of privacy. The e-commerce giants in India, they are already undergoing structural changes. The structural changes necessitated by the recent government order on curtailing the FDI inflows into the e-commerce companies. The e-commerce companies in India, they are undergoing many structural changes. These structural changes are necessitated by the recent rules framed by Ministry of Commerce, and along with that the thrust on data localization is expected to cause few hardships to the e-commerce companies. And considering the employment generated and considering the value added to the GDP from the e-commerce companies, the government should take necessary steps so that the concern for privacy and concern for domestic producers does not impact the economic activity undertaking because of e-commerce companies. The majority of Indian population are involved in informal employment, and informal employment means lack of social security. To provide them with required social security, the government has launched Pradhan Mantri Shram Yogi Mandan Yojana. In the recent budget, the government announced about a new scheme, Pradhan Mantri Shram Yogi Mandan Yojana. The scheme aims at providing social security cover to 42 crore informal workers of India. And what are the prerequisites or the preconditions for people to avail this scheme? A person should be working in an unorganized sector, and he or she should be between the age group of 18 to 40 years. And he or she should not be covered under NPS or any Employment Provident Fund organizations. And last, they should not be an income taxpayer. Only if the informal worker is complying with these conditions, he or she will be eligible to avail the facilities offered under this scheme. And these decisions, these conditions were deliberated in the recently concluded meeting of the Ministry of Labour. And there are few salient features of this Pradhan Mantri Shram Yogi Mandan Yojana. One important feature is that the scheme offers minimum assured pension for the people who are enrolling into the scheme. And the second aspect is that the minimum assured pension is provided by the government, and the payment of premium is shared between both the individual and the central government. It is at the ratio of 50-50%. As an individual, an informal worker will be paying 50% of the premium amount, and the central government will be paying the other 50%, thereby reducing the burden for the informal worker and bringing him or her into the cloud of social security. There is also an option of family pension, where which the family of an individual who has opted for the scheme will be offered the spouse of an individual who has opted for the scheme a 50% of assured pension even after the death of the informal worker. So these are the salient features of the scheme. And in case the subscriber exits in less than 10 years of the contribution, he will get back the share of his contribution only at the rate of savings bank rate, say 4%. And we all know the pension funds should be managed prudently so that the investment made, the precious investment made by the for any pension fund, prudent management of the fund is necessary. The government has chosen LIC as the fund manager for this pension scheme mooted out for informal workers. Third topic is related with the recent model for credit rating agencies mooted by Parliamentary Committee on Finance. The recently concluded budget session of the Indian Parliament, the Parliamentary Committee on Finance has mooted new model for credit rating agencies. We all know that the credit rating agencies are the agencies that analyzes the quality of offer, that analyzes the company's financial strength, and thereby provides a rating. And based on this rating, based on these ratings, the bonds are labeled, and higher the rating, higher the subscription of the bonds, thereby the issuing company gets more fund for its purpose. One important area of concern with Indian credit rating agencies are that we are following issuer pays model. What is this issuer pays model? Say for example, X is a company, it's approaching a credit rating agency Y. The rating provided by the credit rating agency Y is going to impact the subscription of the bond issued by X. So if Y is giving a negative rating, then the subscription goes down. If it gives a positive rating, then subscription increases. And for the service offered by the credit rating agency Y, the amount is paid by the issuer company. This is what issuer pays model is. Since the issuer is paying the service charge to the company which is rating the issuer's bond, it creates a situation of conflict of interest. And this may lead to compromise in quality of analysis. This has been discussed at various fora. Even Economic Survey has spoken about it. Considering this, and after the aftermath of IL&FS crisis, it has become pertinent for the government to rejig the functioning of CRA in India. Keeping all this in mind, the Parliamentary Committee on Finance, they have spoken, they have supported introducing investor or regulator pays model for CRAs. This goes contrary with the earlier committees like Krishnan Committee, which was launched in the year 2009. The Krishnan Committee supported the issuer pays model which is existing now. The recent past, say after the during the subprime crisis, we all know that the lack of credit rating agency diligence led to Lehman crisis which shattered the global economy. So it's high time for the government to review the existing issuer pays model and to opt for investor or regulator pays model. The fourth article speaks about the status of India's waste to energy plants. 143,449 tons of municipal waste generated in India, 40 to 60% are organic. Of the total waste generated in India, 40 to 60% is organic, which means it can be used, it can be recycled, it can be reused in to produce energy. Of the total 40 to 60%, it assumed that the 20% it's not entering the municipal solid waste stream again. And this creates and this necessitates the importance of improving the existing waste to energy power plants in India. But what is the reality? In reality, nearly half of India's waste to energy plants, which are meant to convert the non-biodegradable waste, or defunct, or not in a proper functioning condition. There is also another crisis looming up. There is the segregation of waste is too important for the proper functioning of waste to energy plants. But there is a huge inability in inability prevailing in India in segregation of waste. This has reduced the capacity. Since 1987, we have set up 15 waste to energy plants, but of them, 7 plants have shut down as of now. Key reasons for the closure of these power plants are that since there is a lack of segregation, since we lack ability to segregate the wastes, the key reasons for the closure of the power plants are the inability of the plants to handle solid waste, which is mixed or which is unsegregated. The second reason is the cost of electricity. These waste products are used to produce electricity, and the cost of production is very high, and thereby reducing the profit margin for generators. Those were the important reasons for the closure of waste to energy plants. What are the policy initiatives taken by the government, like the policy notes that support the establishment of waste to energy plants? The first one is under Swachh Bharat Mission, Niti Aayog has proposed constructing 800 megawatt or extracting 800 megawatt energy from waste to energy during the year 2018-19. Also, this paper of Niti Aayog proposes about setting up a Waste to Energy Corporation of India, which would construct incineration plant all over the country through PPP models. And what are the issues being faced in establishing this WTE, that is waste to energy plants? The first fundamental reason is that the quality and composition of the waste. The second is the municipal solid waste in India has low calorific value and it has high moisture content. High moisture content indicates high ash content. Any product with high ash content will not be able to produce good amount of electricity. The third issue is what we discussed earlier, unsegregated waste is coming to the waste energy plant. The last is that in order to burn these waste products, more fuel is required, more fuel is consumed rather than the amount of fuel which is being produced from the power plants. A lack of equilibrium between the power consumed and the power produced is a main issue associated with the waste to energy power plants set up in India. The last article is related with the recent recommendation made by a panel fixing minimum wage at ₹375 per day. Recently, an expert panel has recommended to set up the minimum wage for workers across the country at ₹375 per day. Constitution of India, under the Directive Principles for State Policy, under Article 43, has spoken about providing living wages to citizens of the country. And the recent recommendation of the expert committee is in line with the DPSP provision. The report submitted to the Ministry of Labour and Employment has provided the methodology for fixing the national minimum wage. The minimum wage is a dynamic phenomenon. It varies with the level of industrialization that has happened in the different states. So, the panel has considered the different geographical region to see the local realities and based on the existing socio-economic and labor economic context. And there has been a kind of variation between different states. Based on the different socio-economic and labor market context, the states in the country has been divided into five groups. In highly developed economies where the level of industrialization is more, the minimum wage is fixed more. For example, for the states of Delhi, Goa, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh and Punjab, the minimum wage is fixed at ₹447 per day. For underdeveloped states like Bihar, Uttar Pradesh and West Bengal, the daily wage is fixed at ₹342 per day. So, considering the various factors, the panel has fixed upon the minimum wage for the labors. In 1948, one landmark legislation was passed by Indian Parliament. It was the Minimum Wages Act. This Minimum Wages Act gave power to the states to stipulate minimum wages. And as of now, there is no national minimum wage available in the country. But the national Code on Wages Bill 2017, which is amalgamation of existing wage legislations available in the country, has proposed about setting up a national minimum wage and five regional minimum wages. While recommending that, before proposing this model, Finance Minister also hiked the minimum wages for unskilled non-agricultural workers by 42%. Because of this, their daily wage increased to ₹350 per day. This provision of national minimum wage and five regional minimum wages in Code on Wages Bill 2017 was sent to the Parliamentary Standing Committee, and the Parliamentary Standing Committee said that the central government fixing on minimum wages infringes the rights on state government. Before taking any such actions, the central government has to discuss with the states, and the recent report submitted by the expert panel would help the central government in providing a national minimum wage.